This is a recording of my recent presentation at HRPS, Human Resources, People and Strategy. I attended as a speaker the global conference that was in Denver in April. The title of my presentation is Freedom, Collaboration and Meaning, Three Major Challenges for the HR Profession in the Global Arena. And I'll try to give you an overview of the actual presentation that was much more extended than this one. So basically, the point of departure is that whenever we deal with human resources management, we have to recognize that we operate within a field that's broadly speaking social sciences that has to do with human. And whenever we use the adjective human, we have to consider the meaning of human behind that. And in order to do that, I always think it's important to go back to etymology. So try to understand where the words come from. The reason being that many times the way we describe the world through our words make it real. So if we are in human resources management, we have to recognize that we are talking about men. And you know, if you go back into time, you see that man comes from the ancient word man in German, and it's related to other words like homo. That was the way of describing men in ancient Latin language. And going back, you get to the roots of it all, that's anthropos. And anthropos in ancient Greek meant not just man, but it really meant the all human being, its persona, the person. What we would consider today its individuality, its essence, its being unique somehow. And you know, whenever we work in human resources management, we are dealing with that. And it's very important for us to recognize that there might be very different meanings of human and anthropos. And to my experience, it's very important to recognize how the value and the significance of human has been treated in social sciences. I make reference here to the work by Arnold Gehlen, who was one of the philosophers who created and established a field of philosophy that's called the anthropological philosophy. That means the philosophy that tried to deal with men and with the essence of humanity as compared to other living beings. Arnold Gehlen has a view of man as made of action. So according to Gehlen, the specificity of the of human being is that they are not specialized for anything as compared to other animals who might have claws or might be running fast. The human being is so underspecialized as to be almost unable to compete in the evolutionary race. However, and that's something that Gehlen points out, this characteristic somehow allows man to be free, to have time to think about how to deal with reality. And that's where technology comes in place as a tool to change reality. And again, in Gehlen, man is made of action, is made of its ability of thinking reality under different terms. And according to Gehlen, he is somehow always living into a different realm, both in space and in time. This action brings man to think about the future. And if we think about this essence of man, we see how it's so related to other streams of research in philosophy, like the idea of action that can be found in the work of different philosophers. So if we start from this point of view, we have to recognize that working in human resources management means really having to deal with this inherent force of human beings that are constantly projected toward the future and change, and that make action in terms of their choice, their action, one of their main characteristics. However, there's also a different way of dealing with men that can be embodied by this video. Most of us probably have heard this music, most of us probably have been there. You know, there's something that is fascinating in seeing animated figures out there. But at times, this is also a trend that's so present in the history of humanity that goes in a different way. Instead of recognizing the autonomy, the incredible uniqueness of man, we have been trying to control it, to find a way of creating the perfect man, the man who would obey any kind of orders. And that's the dream of the robot or of the golem, or it's also the dream of the ancient Heron. So the idea of creating the man would do what we wanted him to do. And that's another way of thinking of man, and is what can be called the automata from the ancient Greek automatos. That means actually somebody who's acting without control. So, I mean, without his own control, but under the control of other. And this is another very powerful metaphor. And whenever we deal with human resources management, I contend that we probably did not recognize the fact that human didn't mean to be an automata. And if we look at our results today in HR, let me say, and let me congratulate with most of us, for the first time in history, we made it. We are able to control humans, we are able to manage them, and we're able to manage them to the point that we have data that tell us that we are great into doing that. And you know which data I'm thinking of? I'm thinking of data on empowerment and on engagement. In the past few years, we have seen all those data plummeting. So basically, we keep seeing organizations that have declining levels of engagement, and we wonder why. And I think that it's right, because we are doing our work in a wonderful way. The problem is we think that managing people means creating automata that have to reproduce what we think they should be doing. And you know, by doing that, we are really great by now. We are doing that. But the issue is, will this be the way of managing people that we will keep using in the future? Are we sure that, let's say, the way we interpret human resources management today is exactly what is needed? Are we sure that we can keep doing it like that? And that's where I have my own reflection starting. And my reflection starts, as usual, from my experience and my history. And my experience and my history brought me to look at phenomena within organizations through three different lenses. The first one is the one I'm most accustomed to. I was trained for doing that. As a scientist, I'm a social scientist, I'm a researcher in management and in organization. So, you know, when I look at data that we have, it's quite clear that since our goal to engage people is not being attained, probably what we are doing isn't working. And I know many of you might think, oh no, it's not my fault. It's, you know, the environment, the context, or new social values. You know, might be. But my answer is, whenever I'm trying to change something and I'm not doing that, I have to consider whether I'm using the right cause-effect relation. So as a scientist, I would doubt that we are doing the right things while managing people. Then I'm using my second way of looking at reality. That's something I experienced in my past. That's the seer. I don't want to get too much visionary, but I think that when, as a scientist, we see that the paradigm is not working, we have to break out of that paradigm. And when we break out of that paradigm, we really need to recognize that there might be alternative ways of dealing with things, and there might be something inherently wrong in the way we're doing that. And, you know, by adopting this view, you start thinking about what are the premises on the basis of which we have developed our way of managing people. What are the hidden assumptions there? And I think that one of the hidden assumptions we have is we have to control people. And it's still related to the fact that we are just using this human as an adjective that is over there, but we are not really meaning it in thorough detail. And that's where, you know, I have the third part of me coming into place, the sense maker. So, you know, there are a lot of very brilliant people into human resources management. We see that the paradigm is not working. Then why aren't people changing it? Why aren't we, you know, speaking up to what we have done up today and start doing things in a different way? Again, I'm sure you have a lot of very good explanations for that. My top manager doesn't understand that. Probably yes. You know, employees are not ready to be really autonomous. Might be. It's business needs. Our shareholders wouldn't allow us to do that. Most probably. Still, if you are in the position of taking decisions and you see they're not working, I think there's something very important there to consider. So taking this position as a sense maker, I'm really trying to understand how does it happen that most of us do believe things are not working well now. Why do we keep doing things that we know are wrong? And is there anything we could do in a different way? So we are in the need of deep changes because there are a lot of challenges out there. On one side, you know, the world is really global today and business is really global today. And globalization and diversity are not to be put aside. They are really at the core of the way we're managing businesses around the world. We are in a networked society. Information is flowing everywhere. We cannot control it anymore. There are alternate values and motives, and we have seen it. Things are happening everywhere. They're happening in our back door, they're happening far away, but what's happening is that people are voicing the need to have a different say over the way things come to be managed, even within companies. There's global political unrest. This silly idea that after 1989 everything could be solved has vanished in front of what has happened and what we have gone through. It's something we have to face. And to recognize as part of the new world we are living in. And, you know, we are in a risk society where so many things might happen. And as Ulrich Beck, who is a German sociologist, contends, we are getting into what is reflexive modernity and reflexive rationalization. That means that people will not take things for granted. We have to make sure we engage into dialogues with so many different parts of society and human resources management, that's the news. Also with people that you are managing. They are not taking for granted most of the things we created and we thought might be the legitimate and right way of managing businesses. So there are probably different avenues out of that. And we have seen it in the past. Things come and things go. It's the never-ending cycle of things. So I call them the three C's, and I personally favor one of those, but it's correct to recognize that we might have different ways out. Let's start from the first one, the catastrophe. everything is collapsing. We just need to hold until things will finally fall down. And when that's gonna happen, probably the issues we are raising today will not be important anymore, because we will have much worse issues to deal with. And as I told you, it's happened before. You know, it's happened when the Roman Empire collapsed, and whenever an established order of society collapses, you know, you have the catastrophe. And it might happen today as well. And, you know, if you just take your TV set and browse around different channels, what you see there is that there's a lot of this idea that, you know, we might have big issues in the future, be it for the environment, the nuclear wars, or the aliens, or whatever. But there's this, let's say, subtle idea and perception throughout society that, you know, we might be there. There's an alternative, that's the catharsis. That means try to somehow put aside all the issues we have today, try to calm them down, try to bring along our business as usual way of dealing with things. And again, it's happened. It's happened for several centuries in different parts of the world. You just block and stop everything. You try not to address issues. You try to control stability there. And maybe you're not pushing all society as far as it could be. But, you know, also companies might engage into that. But my point is that this is the right time to get into another way out. That's creation. We have to rethink our assumption. We have to move out of the established ideas that you manage people by controlling them, that you manage people by, you know, using performance management tools, that you manage people by having a function like HR that's subdivided across roles, and that you just order people what to do. That's not the way out. We really need to rethink our assumption. But in order to do that, we need a complete change of paradigm. And the point I'm pushing forward is that we have to embrace new humanism. You probably have heard this word. Humanism was a philosophical movement that brought the Western society out of the Middle Ages. It was based on a very simple assumption, that is, let's put man at the core of everything. So let's start describing the world around us as if we think that man is there. You know, back then, the big issue was how can we deal with the idea that in Western societies, it's God to be at the core of everything and man is not that important. So you might imagine how all those artists back then, starting the process that would lead to Renaissance, or the philosopher, the thinker, the writer, and even some political men, they had to deal with quite a lot of resistance. And it was a very important resistance. It was a resistance based on faith. See, they made it. They were able to bring men at the core of society. And from then on, they started an ongoing process of change of society that brought us today. So what's the point of talking about new humanism? I think that the point is that we have to recognize that through this process, somehow the promises of humanism, as Foucault has said, were not completely fulfilled. And within companies and organizations, I think there's a lot of space for, let's say, pushing forward a new humanism agenda. What are the cornerstones of that? First of all, freedom. Our organizations are not built to allow people to be free. I know, you try to push individuals through incentives. We talk about internal entrepreneurship, autonomy, but at the end of the day, you know, great part of what we do within management and human resources management in particular is trying to find a way to control what's going on. We don't create organizations on the basis of trust. We create them on the basis of the idea that you have to check what's going on there. So in new humanism, men at the core means freedom. And freedom means really recognizing the possibility for individuals to define a greater part of their life than we do today. Second value, meaning. You know, if you put men at the center of reality, the first thing that men will ask is, what's the meaning of me being here? What's the meaning of me contributing to this organization? And you will need to consider that different men will assign different meaning to what you do. And that's one of the biggest issues with most HR practices. They are designed through the lenses of one desired view. But are we sure people are interpreting them in that way? I doubt, really. After 20 years, you know, doing research with companies, talking to people who are in companies, different roles, I sincerely doubt that this is happening. People do have and do assign so different, many different meanings, and you know, it's even worse than that. The same people assign different meanings to practices as time goes by. So, in order to have new humanism, we have to recognize the importance of meaning and of different meaning of the organizational reality that people are entitled to possess. And third, you know, there's something important in humanism. There's this idea that man is not an isolated individual. Man is there in a relation to other men. And that's collaboration, another profound value that comes from new humanism. And it was embedded in the way humanist artists developed their concept. They had these shops where people from different parts of the world would come to learn, to work together, and to create these incredible masterpieces that we can still see today. And then, once we embrace this new view of reality, and it's not that hard, because most of those values are values that we keep in higher consideration in our personal life, but why do we dismiss them within organizations? You know, that's the sense-making thing. Why are we using values that are so different from what we believe into? Is there any reason for doing that? And you know, when we embrace that new humanism, we have to recognize that there are new values that we have to instill into our human resources practices. Uniqueness. People want to feel that they are considered for themselves, unique. I'm not a part of a category, I'm not a part of a professional group, I'm not a part of, you know, a talent management system, I'm myself. And your organization should recognize that before putting me into categories that don't mean anything to me. So people need to feel that they are unique, that the way they deal with the organization is recognized as unique. And, you know, that's so different from what we do today. I know. We're measuring people. We're trying to find some heterogeneity across them. But the problem is that we are setting the rules for that and we are ruling out a lot of heterogeneity that might be of great value when we move out of, you know, the post-Tayloristic era into the time where innovation and creativity do really matter. And, you know, second value that we have to think about is ambiguity. Our systems are designed to give us the illusion that we are perfect, that there's rationality there. And you know, it's so easy to analyze them and prove that it's not true. So again, you know, ambiguity is out there. There are so many ways of interpreting reality. And we've seen, for instance, through social networks, how many different, let's say, blueprints people have in mind. So why shouldn't we embrace ambiguity within organizations and accept the fact that we cannot really measure everything? We are not the perfect calculator out there. We really need to recognize that ambiguity is at the root of modern business today. And third, sociality. Sociality is something different from team working. Sociality is something different from, hey, we can have a great time together, or the basketball ground. Sociality means embedding organization with the values of sharing with others, creating them as places where human beings are able to encounter each other and create meaningful things together. And that again is so different from this idea that we have today of, you know, finding the individual that's unique, yes, but isolated from all the others. And you know, when you're isolated, you don't care about your uniqueness. Uniqueness has a meaning only when you are standing there together with other people. And whenever I look at this picture, I think about so many talents I met that felt so alone. Even though they were brilliant, even though they were overperforming, somehow the way the organization was treating them didn't allow them to be part of the whole social system out there. And if we take these three values, I think the first test we all have to do is, to what extent does your human resources management set of practice respond to these new values? Have you ever tried to do that? I think you should do that. I encourage you to do that. Are we really recognizing uniqueness or just some characteristics that we think might be important, but we're not that much sure about those? Are we embracing ambiguity, the idea that there might be different ways of dealing with things? Are we promoting sociality within our organization? And it's not a matter of establishing a couple of social networks, that's quite a silly thing. It's really creating the environment where they can blossom. And let's go back to HR. Where do all the things we have discussed lead us? I think they lead us to recognizing there's the need of a new HR function. And a new HR function means really departing from the successful benchmark we had in the past. And there are a set of issues that I think are at the core of that. The first one is, we have to get out of the silly idea of splitting roles across. When reality is complex, splitting things doesn't make it more simple. Basically, either you dismiss a lot of that reality and you pretend it doesn't exist, or you're just, let's say, increasing other kinds of cost. So we need integrated problem solving. Human beings and management are so complex that, you know, splitting into shared services, center of expertise, business partners, it's just duplicating activities and costs, and most of the time losing track of what's really relevant to people that you're managing. The focus should not be, you know, the old time idea of strategy versus operation. HR is strategy and operation. It's being there and thinking about the future. It's not about decoupling these two things. There's no way out if we keep doing that. And this is related again to the role models. The approach should be to move out of the idea that we have to standardize, to control, to find ways of measuring human beings, and embrace the idea that HR is about experimenting. Just to give you an example, I found so many times companies that have issues with their performance management reviews. They tell me that they cannot make sense of them, there's something that's not working there, and they try to fix that. And they don't recognize that whenever they have those data that tell them that things are not working, there's a lot to be done, not to fix the system, but to understand why it's not working, what's behind that, what are the frameworks and frames that people are using in reality, so far apart from what you think they should be doing. And that's, you know, that's HR at its very maximum intensity. It's discovering research, it's experimentation, it's trying to find new ways of analyzing reality. What's the problem in that? Probably the competencies. We have not been trained to doing that in the past years. We don't have evidence-based tools. We think that, you know, most of the time it's the old way we do things that might be working best. And the goal becomes harmony. The goal into that is try to find ways to increase harmony within organization. And you know, it's not because by doing that we are playing good, we are being good to other people, it's because harmony is much needed today. We need much more harmony than competition than we used to. And we need to help people really make sense of all the stress that organizational environments are imposing on them. And that's what I think is the move from a mechanic behaviorism, where we think we can control people through tools, to what I call an educated humanism. That's a human resources management approach that makes human really at the core of things. And for sure, you know, even though most of my talk has been on new paradigm, probably a little bit theoretical, mostly theoretical, even though based on all the pain I've seen within organization, and let me tell you, there's a lot of pain there. Not just for, you know, people down on the ladder, even people up there, they are really taking a lot of pain in dealing with all the problems they have to solve. Still, I do think that, you know, this doesn't rule out the importance of trying new ways of solving management problems within an evidence-based paradigm. The problem is, when you start from reality and reality seems to not to be working according to what you think, you have to get out of that paradigm and try another one. But when you do that, you really need to think about how you will analyze, measure, evaluate your new assumptions. So I think that, you know, all the hype on HR evidence-based that comes to be described by this slide is still important and needs to be applied. I'm not contending we have to go into a qualitative HR or a plainly just conversational HR. I'm saying that we need to change the way we deal with HR, and we need to do that in a careful way by employing tools that are based on sound research. And that's why, at the end of this presentation, my encouragement is to start thinking of HR as an ongoing research process on management reality, and embrace that evolutionary and exploratory approach by embedding all of your new practices with inherent processes of collaborative management research. And again, this is an ongoing conversation that I hope will continue through time with companies that are trying to make sense of the big changes that are over there. And as for today, I think that's all. Enjoy your new sense-making experience. Bye.